like to introduce Dr. Sandra Wilks from Southampton University.
Good afternoon. I'm a microbiologist and I work on biofilms, that's my main interest, at Southampton University and within the National Biofilms Innovation Centre. And as Trevor said, I've been doing a programme of work over the last several years looking at understanding better how biofilms form on urinary catheters and what they're actually composed of. And as part of that, we've been running some tests on the UroShield device. So just to start off, I should say I work across the departments of health sciences and biological sciences, and so I'm working with healthcare professionals all the time as well. So a little bit of background information. Why are we interested in biofilms anyway, and what are they? Biofilms are groups of bacteria that will adhere to a surface or an interface, and they form a really quite complex structure. This is not a simple individual bacteria sticking to a surface. They form this sort of 3D architecture, and they surround themselves with a matrix that can be that can be formed of things like polysaccharides, proteins, lipids, and even extracellular DNA. So they have this kind of scaffolding around them. And they have this sort of open but ordered structure where you have nutrient channels sort of running throughout them. So you can start to think of it almost as a multicellular structure rather than individual bacteria. And what does this do? Well, the whole structure itself provides resistance from chemical and mechanical attack, as well as the bacteria behaving differently within the biofilm. So this means when you apply antibiotics, you need a much higher concentration to break through and attack that biofilm. And they can act as a reservoir for pathogens. Why are we interested in catheters? Well, we've known about the importance of biofilms in clinical samples for a long time. We've all just had lunch. If you run your tongue over your teeth, you'll probably feel a little bit of a layer. That's the beginnings of the plaque biofilm that we're all familiar with. The same happens on the surface of any medical device. And so the catheter has the potential to form biofilms on both the external surface and the internal lumen. And we now know that this can really contribute to the risk of UTIs and blockages as well. And added to that, certainly in long-term catheter users, you get this problem of both infections and blockages often reoccurring and happening over and over again, even after repeated antibiotic treatments. If we think of the blockages, we're mainly looking at colonization by a species called Proteus mirabilis, which causes a rapid increase in the pH. And you get all this crystal formation, which causes these incrustations and total catheter blockage. So what are we doing? I'm not going to go into this in any detail at all. If anyone would like information, please feel free to come and speak to me afterwards. But we have a patented microscope system, which allows us to look at large and solid and curved surfaces directly at high magnification without needing to stain or label the bacteria. And this helps us really see that overall structure and architecture. So first of all, what do some clean, unused catheter surfaces look like? These are our EDIC, that's the microscope that we use, images of, on the left-hand side, an unused silicone catheter, and on the right-hand side, a hydrogel latex catheter. And in both cases, you can see that the surfaces are most definitely not smooth. From a bacterial point of view, this is great. They're covered in places that they can attach and start forming these biofilms. So they are not smooth surfaces at all and provide perfect environment for biofilm formation. If we start looking at how the biofilms form, these are just some example images using E. coli. So these are E. coli on catheters in the laboratory in an artificial urine medium. And on the top left-hand side, we have an EDIC image showing this very disordered surface, and hopefully you can just make out that there are some areas that are darker than others. And if we then use specific bacterial stains, we can match the bacteria to those areas. So that's where we're starting to see biofilm formation. And in the case of E. coli, which is not a strong biofilm former, you're still getting extensive biofilm colonization of the surface. When you look at something like Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which loves to form a biofilm, you get a really rapid biofilm forming. So here, on the top left-hand side, we've got the situation after only 6 hours. And what you can see here is a thick mat of Pseudomonas covering the whole surface with just a few channels running in between. After 24 hours, on the right-hand side, we've got total coverage. There's no exposed catheter left. But then the interesting bit, and it's an important feature of biofilms, within another 24 hours, you're looking at more of a mosaic structure. So you've got areas where the bacteria have removed. And this is an important aspect of biofilms. It's a very dynamic structure. So you get areas that slough away and allow recolonization of any surface, and the catheters in particular. I mentioned Proteus and the problems of blockages and encrustations. And Proteus form a crystalline biofilm. And here we've got some examples again. I'm not going to go through these in detail, but on the top left-hand side, we've got the situation after only a couple of days exposure to Proteus. You get total coverage of the catheter, and you get a layer of crystals forming on the top. After 4 days, you get a huge amount of microcrystalline production. And that's what's shown in the bottom two images. So you get this diffuse crystalline material that's called apatite, and you get these defined struvite crystals. As we leave them longer, we can start looking a bit more about what this means. We've always thought of these crystals as being a purely chemical process. But when you look at them in detail, you find that the crystals and those encrustations are actually just providing another surface for the biofilm. So here, we've got some struvite crystals in the centre of each image, and they're actually covered in bacteria. So again, it's building layer upon layer of this very dynamic, very complex system. And that's what I really want to stress. It's a very, very complex environment and situation that we're trying to deal with. These are all on silicone catheters, but we also see the same with hydrogel-coated catheters. So the hydrogel does not prevent this from happening. So what kind of approaches can we use? Well, over the years, there's been lots of different approaches applied to look at antimicrobial catheters. Many have resorted to using impregnated or coated materials, such as adding antibiotics, or materials such as silver. I expect you're all familiar with the idea of the silver-coated catheters. And with any of these kind of approaches, we tend to find lots of problems. So the bit of data I'm showing here, and again, a very simple take-home message. In the three graphs, we've got E. coli forming biofilms over 4 days, and the first graph is on silicone on the top left-hand side. Then we've got hydrogel latex, and then we've got a silver-coated catheter. And all you need to notice is that there's no difference between any of them. The biofilm forms the same way. The big issue with any of these active material type approaches is, of course, the potential to form antimicrobial resistance, which we know is a major issue. And it's always going to be difficult with any chemical approach for that not to happen eventually. And resistance develops extremely quickly within the biofilm environment. What about mechanical methods? Well, we know there are things like bladder washouts, which can be used. But again, bacteria are very good at withstanding the shear forces against the catheter itself. So while you may clear some of those encrustations, you've probably still got that layer of bacteria below. We've just carried out a lab study using the UroShield device, and this generates a low-frequency surface acoustic wave, very low-frequency ultrasound, which clips on, the actuator clips onto the base of the catheter, the outside surface, and the waves are transmitted along the length of the catheter, both on the external surface and the internal lumen. We've been testing this in a couple of model lab setups, and one of these has included a laboratory bladder model. Now, this has been used in many studies over the years, and it's basically a glass vessel which is mimicking the bladder. It allows us to keep it at the correct temperature, and you can insert the catheter, inflate the balloon. We use a physiologically correct artificial urine medium, and then we can sample the catheter. So it's a very controlled system. I'm not going to go through many results, but these are just a few of the results that we've got. Here, we are showing the percentage reduction in biofilm formation on UroShield-treated catheters compared to an untreated control. And what we're seeing is that after 48 hours, on the top left-hand side, with E. coli, we're getting a close to 100%. It actually works out at around 99% reduction in biofilm formation in this sample. For Proteus, we found that we could achieve that level sometimes, but depending on the positioning of the area of the catheter we were sampling from, that was sometimes fall to around 50%. And with Pseudomonas, the results were more variable, with certain sections getting almost that 98, 99%, but then other areas showing no difference. Now, it's important to consider several points here. First of all, we have that heterogeneous nature of the biofilms. It changes all the way down the catheter, so we have to bear that in mind. But also, we have to consider our lab model. We're using a very high concentration of bacteria, far higher than we would find in a person, because we are incubating the bacteria, so they're growing very quickly. So any reduction is a really good result. And we also are lacking all the host, the human immune response factors, which will be working in conjunction as well. So this is very much preliminary work. So just really to conclude my part of this talk, I really wanted to stress how complex and how difficult treating biofilms is. So bacteria will attach incredibly rapidly, certainly within a couple of hours, but actually we find them attaching within minutes. And you've got this other material. You're not just dealing with bacteria. So you've got this glue, this other structural material that's holding the whole system together. Those complex crystalline biofilms can form very quickly. And once they start forming, you can see how you're basically trying to get through all of that material. It's very difficult to clear. There are alternative control methods, but anything based on chemicals or active compounds, we have to be mindful of the risks of resistance development. With the UroShield, we have got variable results in the lab, in our flow system, but we are providing an extremely worst case scenario. And in some cases, we were getting a good reduction, so up to around 99% removal and reduction in colonization. There are various explanations for this. I've mentioned about the immune system, and certainly that's likely to be a major factor. But also, it's important to remember with any lab study, in the natural environment, biofilms are rarely composed of just one bacterial species. There'll be a whole range of species. So we can start thinking of the urinary microbiome. So what's there? And certainly, all the recent studies are showing us that urine isn't sterile, as we've always thought. and definitely not for long-term catheter users. So we need to look at whether this device is disrupting the community structure of those biofilms, and whether it's actually encouraging removal of pathogenic species. And we are about to do a study linked to that. So as I say, we're about to do a small microbiome study. And this will also involve looking directly on some patient catheters, so we can start seeing how accurate our model is as well. And this is being funded through the National Biofilms Innovation Centre, where we're trying to bring some of the techniques that we use in our research to help with product development and industry moving forward. And just to finish on my part, I just wanted to leave you with this short movie that I hope will work, where we are travelling through a crystalline biofilm. So hopefully you'll see that we're coming into focus now. And as we move down, we've surrounded by all this diffuse crystalline material with these struvite crystals covered in bacteria. It's a really complex environment. It is not like a basic bacterial cell. It's very difficult to treat.